Now we have a session that is perhaps at the core of Tehelka's own work, which is on the issue of dissent and what we've called it democracy's jackboot. The idea today, increasingly and worryingly, is that they're only a kind of monochromatic approach to thought, a monochromatic approach to growth, a monochromatic approach to development, a monochromatic approach even to the idea of what citizenship is. Anybody who protests against the dominant narrative is outlawed by the government and also by the media. You're either declared Maoist, you're declared anti-national, you're declared anti-development, you're declared anti-something. And it is really strange that in a plural democracy like India, we have begun to become afraid of plural thought. Today in this session, we have three people who represent different modes of thinking across the country. When they speak on stage today, they will be speaking for a whole hinterland of people that hardly ever make it to the news, that hardly ever get talked about, and they are the underbelly of India that we rarely come face to face with. I often say that India is not one country, it's two continents. And when people protest against a particular face of India, they're not anti-Indian democracy, because they're not anti the Indian democracy that you and I experience. Their experience of Indian democracy is something completely different. It is much more rapacious, it is oppressive, and it could be North Korea. That is something that we fundamentally need to understand today. To protect their right to speak is to protect ourselves. So today we have Sunder Rajan, who is a legal advocate from South India, somebody who has been speaking up for the Kudankulam protesters. He represents many of them who have false cases and have been arrested. We have Sudha Bharadwaj, another lawyer from Chhattisgarh, one of the most courageous women I know, who represents and takes up cases that almost the entire legal fraternity would rather not take up. And we have Kamla Kaka, a 26-year-old girl from a village called Sarkiguda in Chhattisgarh, where barely a month and a half ago, there was a terrible massacre in the middle of the night when 19 tribals were shot dead, and overnight they were declared Maoists. It took a while before the truth began to emerge, and it turned out that most of them, in fact, all of them, were tribals who had gathered for a harvest festival, and frightened forces shot at them. Several children died in that massacre, including her 14-year-old brother, and yet, when she speaks up, today she stands on that cusp when she will be declared, like many of us, as Maoists. To listen to their stories, please welcome Sunder Rajan, Sudha Bharadwaj, and Kamla Kaka, and my colleague Sanjay, who is the editor of the Hindi magazine that has really overtaken the English magazine. I take great pride in inviting him. Sudhaji, as I've already outlined, you know that there is an increasing intolerance for any kind of alternative thought in our polity now. As a lawyer, you've seen some of this really up close, seen this kind of intolerance. Could you share with our audience today some of the cases that would exemplify what we just spoke about?
Well, I think to understand, yes, I would like to talk about some of the cases. But to understand it, because it appears to be utter madness, I think we have to understand a little bit of the method in the madness. I think despite all the very confident posturing, the reality is that there is a very severe international financial crisis going on in the world today. And we can see that reflected everywhere. I mean, Greece, Spain, Occupy Wall Street, Britain's strikes and so on. And it's very, very evident that there are only two ways to get over that. One way is to take back whatever are the hard-won rights of workers and employers in the West, employees and people at general, what they've got, welfare measures in the West. The other is to intensify the loot of resources. And what we're witnessing, I think, today in India, and particularly this entire belt from Bengal, Jharkhand, Orissa, Andhra Pradesh, including Chhattisgarh and Maharashtra, it's an entire tribal belt. This is probably the biggest indigenous belt now, which is struggling very hard to resist the loot of natural resources. And I think this is a reality that we have to come to terms with. Because all over, capitalism has meant suppression of indigenous people in these kind of circumstances. And in this belt, you have all kinds of resistance movements. You have tribal communities, you have NGOs, you have people with bows and arrows, and you have also people with guns. So it's an entire gamut of resistance. And unfortunately, I think what the writing on the wall, which we are not seeing, is that probably the viewpoint which they are representing is something which has to be taken into account. It's the other pole. And I think when Kamla talks about her village, that is really the other pole and why it is happening. In Chhattisgarh, we are seeing a suppression of dissent, which is, it's almost, it's like Asim Trivedi's cartoon. I mean, the kind of people who are facing sedition charges, the kinds of people who are going in jail under the Chhattisgarh Vishesh Jan Suraksha Adhiniyam, it's a public security act. You know, that is an act which says the tendency, even a tendency to interfere with the maintenance of public order. Now, that is so vague. The entire definition of unlawful activity has been made so very vague that it can include any kind of dissent. So, in general, I mean, and particularly when there's an issue of, just as we're speaking here now, a global investors meet is going on in Chhattisgarh, and people are being invited to come in and loot more natural resources. So you've got the whole of Raigarh. The coal block allocation is the top story today. You've got the whole of Jhansgir Champa, which was the most irrigated district of Chhattisgarh, 78% irrigated, whereas the rest of Chhattisgarh is just 20%. You have 34 power plants coming up in just one block. You've got Jashpur, where I think almost the entire Jashpur district has been now parceled off into mining licenses and prospecting licenses. You've got the entire cement belt between Raipur and Bilaspur, where you've got Lafarge and Holcim coming in. And the what it means is that people who are protesting, you've got Ramesh Agarwal, there was an attempt to murder him. You've got Bhagwati Sahu, a trade unionist who was in jail for 13 months. The accusation is ridiculous that he was trying to loot a mobile from a security officer. That man is a trade unionist. He's also an elected Janpad representative leader. There's no question of. You had, of course, the celebrated case of Vinayak Sen. But you have more such cases. You have Prakash Korram. He belongs to an NGO. He was doing work for payment of Narega wages in Kanker. He was put in the Jan Suraksha Adhiniyam. There were two cases which were linked together. And Kartam Joga is the petitioner of that case. He's the man who went to the Supreme Court, taking all that material about Salva Judum, the people who died, the houses which were burnt. Kartam Joga has been in jail for the last 2.5 years. Nobody has even heard about him. There are thousands of Adivasis now languishing in those jails. Because what is happening is that the security forces are picking up whoever they can find. The cases against Naxalites are usually against unknown persons. People are put into jail. They are brought before a magistrate. Usually the magistrate does not even speak the language. There are no interpreters in the court. It's an absolute failure of criminal justice, and people are going into jail, and then because you're in such a grievous offense, you are not being brought to the court because they say they don't have guard to bring you there. So you stay there in jail and your trial just does not happen. There's so many people, old, ill people who are in jail today.
Yes, Sudha, there was a famous case of a 60-year-old woman who was arrested as a big Maoist activist in Orissa. And it's only when journalists went there and exposed her story that the government even accepted that this old and very frail lady, I wish we had her photograph, who could not possibly be a Maoist leader. And before we move to Sunder Rajan, I'd like to tell all of you who were here last year that you gave a standing ovation to Dayamani Barla, the tribal activist from Jharkhand. Today, she is languishing in jail. There is no media that is supporting that. She was arrested for what? because she was agitating in front of a block development officer's office for the fair distribution of NREGA funds. She has been arrested for that. When she got bail, the state government rearrested her for the same case, and she's today in jail without bail, and there is no attention on her. Please remember the woman that you gave a standing ovation to last year and introspect about the kind of democracy we've become. Sunder Rajan, you are part of one of the big flashpoints in Indian polity now, the Kudan Kulam protest. I'd like you to talk about two things. One is the legal assault on those who protest. There are 8,000 sedition cases that have been filed against the protesters. But also, do answer this question that often comes, which is, if we are going to resist against every form of power generation, and I often face that in the editor's office, we are against coal, we are against thermal, we are against hydro, we are against nuclear, we are against pretty much everything. How can we get power, and where does the Kudan Kulam narrative fit in that?
Yeah, see, before I answer your question, Shoma, I would like to tell an anecdote, which would be even, currently, it will actually gel with the current situation. It happened about 35, 38 days back during the emergency days in Madurai, when the MISA was clamped and the police were looking for some communist leaders and communist party workers. So there was a place, they were arresting all the communist leaders and the party workers, and they were asked to get into the jeep. And there was a stand-up, passerby, he was there, and the police asked him to get inside the jeep. He said, I'm anti-communist, he said that. The police said, you are some communist, so get inside the jeep, So it's a warning, my dear friends, even if you say pro-nuclear, there's a chance that you might get inside, because nuclear, according to Indian establishment, can be spoken only by the Prime Minister or Mr. Narayan Sami, nobody else. See, these people in Kudan Kulam have been protesting. None of us, even in Tamil Nadu or outside India, would know Idindakarai, a small, district village, even about 450 days back. These people have been struggling. What are they asking? Are they asking you a share in the 1.76 lakh crore? Are they asking you two flats in Adarsh Housing Society? Are they asking you two coal blocks in the coal fields? Nothing. They want power to be produced using solar and wind. What is so seditious about that? There are 150,000 cases. I mean, we are planning to enter the Kudan Kulam police station into Guinness Book of Records. 150,000 cases have been filed. 90% are nameless. Believe me, 90% are nameless. What they will write every day? Uday Kumar Pushparayan plus 5,000. Uday Kumar Pushparayan Maipa Jaisraj plus 3,000. So I, you, or anybody in this crowd, or anybody in the country can be arrested saying that you are wearing a green shirt which Uday Kumar was wearing on that day, so you might be, booked in. So that is the case of, they are trying to do it with a very iron-handed thing. Number one is the question that I want to get into is, there are about 8,500 odd cases, sedition cases, and waging war against the country, 124A and 121A. Kasab has got only one sedition case. Uday Kumar has got 13 sedition cases. Pushparayan has got 13 sedition cases. So is this a democracy? What do these people want? They have been fighting. They have been, it's a right, to sit in a place near their sea, which they have been living for generations, and protesting against the plant, which they were never heard of. There is no public opinion conducted in setting up this nuclear plant, because the government used whole thing that, by 1989, they didn't have a law to ask the public before they construct this plant. So, out of that, four are juveniles. Can I have those images? I've got those juvenile images. Four juveniles, each about 14, 15, 16 years. They have been booked under 124A and 121A, which is basically sedition, waging war against the country. So where are we moving? To answer your question, where do we go for power? Are we ask the government to move this struggle? If you say it's an anti-nuke struggle, it's not an anti-nuke struggle at all. It is a struggle that is happening in this country to entirely change the energy policy of our country. We are now a centralized, demand-based electricity generation country. We want the country, the government, to look at decentralized, need-based electricity generation. I can give you a whole bunch of stuff. India's got about 5,900 sub-districts. Sub-districts could be block, mandal, tahsil, whatever it is. Out of this 5,900 sub-districts, about 80% of the sub-districts require only about 15 to 20 megawatt of power. So you can produce those 20 megawatt of power then and there using a hybrid of either solar, wind, biomass, ocean thermal. You've got a whole bunch of options. And for the larger cities like Delhi, Bombay, Chennai, you could use your hydro or the thermal plants as of now, till you end up with a larger alternative. See, we see a situation Energy conservation. Nobody is talking about energy conservation. Why is nobody talking? Because I read an article given by the Bureau of Energy Efficiency in India. It's a government-run body. It's not a body run by me or Uday Kumar. Nobody. It's a government-run body. They have said if India is able to, invest much on the energy efficiency, we would be able to save roughly about 35% to 40% of the energy. Which means out of 2 lakh megawatt of installed capacity today, we would easily give up about 80,000 megawatt. So where do you put the money? Into the nuclear plant or into energy efficiency? Our transmission and distribution systems are the worst in the world. We are talking about comparing China. China has got a AT&C loss, aggregate technical and commercial loss. It's about 8%. We have got about 32%. So it's a question of where you put your money. Just because somebody has a technology, somebody wants to make nuclear. We are not convinced that nuclear reactors are for power. What we get a meager, after investing lakhs and lakhs of crores of rupees from 1960, right from Homi Baba days till today, we are getting only about 4,780. It's an installed capacity. What we get is a different story. We have spent lakhs and crores of rupees into that nuclear plant. We get only 2.7% of our power requirement. Even the government says by 2030-40, they'll produce about 8%, not 80%, 8% of our power using nuclear plants. So can't we manage without nuclear plants? First step, they are not ready to hear that. See, that is the option. They are not ready to hear the alternatives.
Yeah, in fact, Sunder Rajan, what you point out, as I was saying that...
Thank you.
We have a kind of emergency against thought in our country today because we are in a kind of soundproof room where we are cut off from any other possibility of thinking. And what Sunder Rajan has spelled out, many people are now trying to talk about this decentralized idea of energy where we can have plural ways of doing it, mini grids, where this transmission is less, the loss of transmission is less, the distributive justice is better. And as he just said, they are not fundamentalist about this and they accept that for some big industry, you will need other forms, thermal, hydro and all of that. All of it can coexist. It's just that it doesn't have to be only one way of doing it. Sanjay, speak to Kamla about her story.
मुझे लगता है कि हम सबको कमला के बारे में जानने की ज़रूरत है कमला सुबह से इंग्लिश नहीं जानने के बाद हम सब लोगों को सुन रही हैं तो मुझे लगता है कि हमें भी क्योंकि हमारी जानकारी अगर हम कमला के बारे में नहीं जानेंगे तो एक तरफा होगी और वो ठीक नहीं होगी और एक और तरीका है शायद तरुण शहरावत के बाहर फोटोग्राफ्स हैं कमला की कहानी वाले फोटोग्राफ्स हैं वो तीन ऐसे गाँव के फोटोग्राफ हैं जिनको पिछले साल जिसमें 300 घरों में हमारा जो सिस्टम है उसने पुलिस ने सीआरपीएफ ने आग लगा दी और वो तरुण ने फोटो खींचे वही कहानी कमला की कमला मैं चाहता हूँ कि आप जुलाई जून से पहले मेरे ख्याल से आप बिल्कुल खेती करती थी अकेली कमला खेतों में काम करती थी अपना खाना उगाती थी जो भी है और खाती थी आराम से क्या हुआ था ऐसा जिसने आपकी पूरी ज़िंदगी बदली
जुलाई 28 के हमारे गाँव में जैसे मतलब परंपरा रीति रिवाज है जो कि हम लोग बीज का त्यौहार मनाते हैं तो उस दिन हम लोग 28 तारीख के पूरे गांव वाले जमा होके हमारे गांव के अंदर मतलब बैठे थे उसके पूजा पाठ के बारे में चर्चा करने के लिए बातें करने के लिए वहां पे कई सारे बातें होती है जैसे ज़मीन जायदाद किसी को है किसी को नहीं है किसी कोई करने वाला है और कोई गरीब है कोई अमीर है तो उसमें सारी मदद के बारे में भी बात किया जाता है जैसे कोई गरीब है किसी के घर में करने वाले नहीं हैं और कोई अमीर है तो जैसे मतलब हम लोग एक ग्रुप बना लेते हैं चार पांच घर वाले मिलकर उसे मतलब ऐसे मिलकर काम करते हैं खेती काम हो जो भी काम हो जैसे तो वो सारी बातें वहाँ पे मतलब चर्चा हो रही थी उस दिन और ख़ास तौर पर जैसे ज़मीन के बारे में चर्चा हो रही थी तो अचानक पुलिस फोर्स ने पूरे चारों तरफ से घेर ली उसके बाद कोई वार्निंग नहीं ना ही किसी ने कुछ मतलब पूछा तक नहीं कि तुम लोग इस जगह पे क्या कर रहे हो और चारों तरफ से घेर ली एकदम अचानक फायरिंग शुरू कर दी जैसे फायरिंग शुरू हुआ उसके बाद कुछ लोग खड़े होकर बोल रहे थे कि हम जनता हैं तो कुछ लोग जो मतलब कुछ लोग लेट गए थे कुछ लोग घर के मतलब घर मन पास था वहाँ घुस गए थे और जो कड़े होके बोल रहे थे कि हम जनता हैं तो उन्हीं लोगों को गोली लग गई और इतने देर तक चली कि कम से कम 1-1.5 घंटा चली गोली उसके बाद पूरा उजाला बम फेंके फिर सभी डेड बॉडी को जमा किए और उसके बाद फिर सारे लोगों को जमा किए जो लोग वहाँ पे थे मौजूद जिंदा, और कुछ लोग घायल भी हो गए, और उन लोगों को जमा किए। उसके बाद उन लोगों को इतना मारा कि तुम लोग नक्सलाइट हो कि नहीं बताओ। और जैसे वहाँ पे कुछ महिलाएं थी, कुछ मतलब बुजुर्ग महिलाएं भी थी, कुछ मतलब जवान जो पढ़े मतलब पढ़ने वाले बच्चे भी थे, तो उनके साथ भी अब छेड़तानी की और इतना तंग किया कि अब जहाँ तक कि रेप करने की बात बोले उन्होंने कि बोले कि हम रेप करने वाले हैं, हमें ऊपर से नीचे तक एक बार देखिए, हम इंसान नहीं हैं, हम रेप करके मारने वाले हैं, तुम लोग को कड़े कड़े रेप करके मार देंगे, तुम लोग क्या कर लोगे, तुम लोग को सारे गांव को मतलब गोली चला के भून देंगे, तुम लोग क्या कर लोगे। इस तरह उनके साथ प्रताड़ित किया गया है। उसके बाद राती रात फिर गाड़ी मन आया, उसके बाद एम्बुलेंस भी आया, और जितने लोग घायल हुए थे उनको भी लेके गए, और जो जिंदा थे और जो मरे थे जिनका डेड बॉडी भी उठा के ले गए था ना, उसके बाद रात भर फोर्स वहाँ थी। रात के तो 16 लोगों को मारे हैं, उसके बाद रात भर वहाँ फोर्स थी, सारे लोगों को ले गए। उसके बाद सवेरे फिर एक लड़का को मारे, उसका नाम है रमेश।
आपको इससे पहले भी आपको अपना गांव छोड़ना पड़ा था?
जी, इससे पहले जैसे सलवा जुड़ुम के समय अब इतना परेशान कर दिए पुलिस वालों ने कि उस समय भी हमारे गांव के एक आदमी को मार दिए, तब भी हम चुप रहे, कुछ नहीं बोल पाए। उसके बाद हमारे आंखों के सामने 2 घर जला दिए, तब भी कुछ नहीं बोले। उसके बाद फिर से कुछ लोगों को पकड़ के जेल ले गए। उसके बाद डेली मतलब समस्या बढ़ते गया। उसके बाद हम लोग को वहाँ रहना मुश्किल हो गया। अब पूरे बासागुड़ा जितने भी हमारे गांव के चारों तरफ थे, मतलब गांव था, वो पूरे लोग चल बसे थे, अपना अपना जीने के लिए आंध्रा कहीं कहीं चले गए। तो इसीलिए हम लोग को भी यहाँ रहना उचित नहीं है, दिनों दिन समस्या बढ़ रहा है, अब रहने से पूरा आग लगा देंगे, ये समझ के हम लोग भी चले गए। उसके बाद हम लोग आए 2009 में। आने के बाद फिर हम लोग अपना जीवन यापन छोटे छोटे झोपड़ी मन बना के जी रहे थे।
तो कमला, वो पुलिस कहती है, सरकार कहती है कि आप लोग माओवादियों को सपोर्ट करते हैं, माओवादियों का साथ देते हैं, तो इसमें कितनी सच्चाई है? क्या मजबूरी में ऐसा करना पड़ता है कि नक्सल आते हैं और आपको मजबूरी में उनका साथ देना पड़ता है तो पुलिस वाले आपको परेशान करते हैं, और पुलिस वालों के पास आप जाएं तो नक्सल परेशान आपको करते हैं, माओवादी, ऐसा है क्या?
नहीं, ये समस्या मैं तो आज तक नहीं जानी हूँ, और आज तक हमारे गांव में माओवादी आकर हमें परेशान नहीं किया है, और हमारे गांव में कभी घुसे भी नहीं, और हमारा गांव इतना नज़दीक है पुलिस थाना से कि जो गया उन्हीं को पता है।
तो आपको क्या लगता है क्यों इतना पुलिस वाले या जनता सरकार आपको परेशान करती है, कोई आपको वजह समझ में आती है? पुलिस और सरकार का आपके लिए मतलब क्या है?
जिस दिन से कांड हुआ, इससे पहले भी इतने सारे परेशानियां हुए, सलवा जुड़ुम पैदा होकर हमारा सब कुछ धन दौलत जो भी था हम बरसों से कमा के रखे थे, वो सब खत्म होने के बाद भी हमको समझ में नहीं आया, और हम ना ही कुछ सोचते थे भी नहीं। लेकिन आज जिस दिन से कांड हुआ उस दिन से लेकर आज तक का, मेरे को आज तक का भी समझ में नहीं आता कि ये पुलिस वाले और ये सरकार हमारे हम गरीबों के पीछे क्यों पड़ी है। हम सोचते हैं कि हम आज़ाद हैं, लेकिन आज हमें ऐसा लगता है कि हम आज़ाद नहीं हैं, हमको घुट घुट कर जीना पड़ रहा है। हम ना ही चैन से खा सकते हैं, चैन से घूम सकते हैं, ना ही चैन से रह सकते हैं, हमको केस जाने के लिए मुश्किल होता है। उस दिन जैसे डेड बॉडी को थाना ले गए, उसके बाद सवेरे एक जन को मार के ले गए, उसके बाद हम लोग सवेरे वो डेड बॉडी के पीछे पीछे हम लोग थाना गए, दिन भर रहे थाना के सामने, धूप में चिल्लाते रहे, चीखते रहे, हमारा डेड बॉडी दिखा, कितने लोगों को मारे हैं हमको समझ में नहीं आ रहा है, किसी को घुसने नहीं दिए पुलिस वालों ने। उसके बाद दिन भर रहे शाम के 6-7 बजे हमारा डेड बॉडी दिए, उसके बाद पोस्टमार्टम भी नहीं किए हैं, उसके बाद रात के ले गए। फिर हम लोग दूसरे दिन अब अंतिम संस्कार कर दिए. जिस दिन अंतिम संस्कार किए उस दिन पुलिस वाले ने पूरे आके जितने भी खून मतलब उनका गिरा था, जो लोग मरे थे उनका खून को उठा के ले गए, क्योंकि उनको पता चला था होगा एक मनीष कुंजाम जी और कुवासी लखमा जी दूसरे दिन जाने वाले थे, ताकि सबूत ना रहे. इसीलिए अंदर भी, जैसे अंदर भी मारे ना, तो घर के अंदर अंदर भी जो खून था उनको भी उठा के ले गए और ले गए. और उसके बाद वो सबूत मतलब वो खून भी उठा के ले गए. उसके बाद चार पाँच दिन के बाद फिर हमारे गांव में, ताकि दूर नहीं है थाना से, दूर नहीं है, और हमारे गांव के मतलब हमारे गांव में ही फिर कैंप लगा दिए पुलिस वालों ने. कैंप लगाया उसके बाद तो कैंप लगाए उस दिन से तो और भी प्रताड़ित किया जा रहा है. और ना ही हमको खेत जाने देते हैं, ना ही हमारे गांव में गाय चराने देते हैं, ना ही स्कूल जाने देते हैं. और तो और एक 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 माता ने एक दिन खेत गई थी और उसका छोटा बच्चा था एक दो महीना का. और उन्होंने जब खेत जाके आ रही थी अपने बच्चे को दूध पिलाने के लिए, पुलिस वालों ने उनको पकड़ कर बिठा दिया 2-3 घंटा. उसके बाद वो बेचारी बोली कि मैं जाऊंगी, तो नहीं बैठो. तो फिर बोली नहीं मेरा बच्चा है मैं दूध पिलाने जाऊंगी. तो उन्होंने बोल मतलब उन्होंने कहा कि सबूत क्या है, तुम बच्चे की माँ हो. बेचारी दूध निकाल कर दिखाई, उसके बाद जाने दिया. मैं आप लोग सबसे पूछती हूँ, क्या ये पुलिस और ये अपने भारत देश की सरकार क्या माँ का दूध नहीं पिया है? मैं कहती हूँ क्या वो माँ के कोख से जन्म नहीं लिया है कि महिलाओं के साथ इतनी सारी प्रताड़ित किया जा रहा है? और तो और हम अकेले घूम नहीं सकते.
आप कभी हथियार उठाएंगे? जो आपके ऊपर हो रहा है आप कभी हथियार उठाने को मन करता है आपको?
आप मैं तो बता नहीं सकती.
I would urge all of you to go on to YouTube and write Kamla Kaka on YouTube. You will see a bone-chilling video where Kamla, barely 26 years old, and as she said before this incident, just somebody who was farming her field, you will see her single-handedly holding off the district administration. In a frenzy, she keeps asking them, because soon after the Sarkiguda massacre, the district administration came to give rations to the village. And Kamla had the logical coherence to ask the government that if you have just shot 19 of our villagers, including my brother, as a nakshal, then why have you come to give us rations? And she is repeatedly asking on that YouTube video, ki agar hum nakshal hai to aap rations kyon de rahe hai? And she pushed the district administration back. That village refused to take the rations till the government acknowledges that the people who were shot there that day are Indian citizens, part of our democracy, merely meeting for a harvest festival. Sudha, we've run out of time. There's just so much more to talk about. But, you know, if you were to just make a few closing remarks about what is the way that we can get around this very imprisoning way of thinking that has crept into Indian democracy.
Well, to start with, what I feel is that, for example, what the question that you are asking her, why do you think this is happening to you? As I just said, that basically it was a strategy of draining the water to kill the fish. And it is a very old strategy, strategic hamleting, they called it in Vietnam, and they've done it so many places else. So basically take away the people and put them in roadside camps, and then maybe you can mine or put plants or do whatever you want. There are thousands of hectares there which are in mining leases today, and their MOUs and all that. I think what we people in Chhattisgarh, the Democrats are saying, is that first please rehabilitate everybody, as was said by the Supreme Court, as was said by the NHRC. Rehabilitate people. There's still about 50,000 people in Andhra Pradesh who have fled away from these villages. Kamla's village is very brave. Not every village is so brave. They would have just run away. So please bring them back. Please give them forest rights. You've said your historic injustice has to be rectified. Please rectify it. Give your parliament has passed an act called the PISA Act. Please give the provisions of the PISA Act. Let people decide what they want and persuade them. If you really think development is very good for them, persuade them. That would be the democratic way. And I think also that is the only way for peace. That is the only way for de-escalating violence. Otherwise, violence will just go on increasing.
I just wanted to share with you that the reason we thought of bringing Kamla Kaka, and if you see that YouTube video, you'll understand, the moment there is anybody who asserts themselves in these parts, they are seen as a threat. We have Soni Sori, who's in jail. She's a tribal woman, and her nephew, who was training to be a journalist, one of the first tribal journalists out of Chhattisgarh. Because they were speaking up, they have become suspect. Both of them are in jail. Kamla today is in that fragile space. A cataclysmic event occurred. She has spoken up. And today, she lives in that gray zone where any day, the state may declare her an enemy of the state. And finally, Sunder Rajan has come today because Professor Uday Kumar couldn't. He is an engineer. He has a PhD. He is an extremely erudite man. But he has been declared a major enemy of the state. He wanted to come to Goa, but the village would not let him because they said if he steps out of that village, then it is quite likely that the state will arrest him because they believe that he is a foreign hand. There's so many stories that have left, that are still left untold, still left unsaid. I would really urge you to delve a little deeper into the layers that make up Indian democracy. And believe me, it is part of the narrative that will keep us safe. Thank you so much for listening in. And thank you, Kamla.